Our system is rigged. Anyone who challenges their control is deemed a sexist, a racist, a xenophobe, and morally deformed.
Conspiracy theories are at the heart of this American presidential election.
This is a conspiracy against you, the American people.
Since the Vietnam War and the Watergate scandal, many Americans have been deeply suspicious of their rulers.
History is a set of lies agreed upon. The government rarely tells you the truth, and they never tell you the whole truth.
Americans are always looking for the conspiracy behind the facts. We were really taught to do that in Vietnam. It's just a complete deception in which 58,000 Americans were killed.
Donald Trump has made his political career pushing conspiracies. He's alleged that President Obama could be a foreign imposter.
The people that went to school with him, they don't even know, they never saw him. They don't know who he is. Crazy.
It's the biggest fraud in maybe the history of the world.
All right, thank you, and God bless America.
He suggested that the father of one of his rivals was linked to the assassination of JFK.
There's a picture of her, him and crazy Lee Harvey Oswald.
Ted Cruz's father linked to JFK assassination. What's wrong about that?
This is nuts.
Now he faces an opponent with her own scandal-ridden past.
You delete 33,000 emails.
Her instincts are to cover up, and the laws are for the little people.
Not to mention the sins of her husband.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
Extraordinary personal and bitter attacks have defined this election.
She was a total enabler. She would go after these women and destroy their lives.
Donald thinks belittling women makes him bigger.
In the face of so many conspiracies, what can American voters really believe?
One thing I can promise you this, I will always tell you the truth.
Take the oath, Senator?
I am.
In January 2009, Barack Obama was sworn into office as America's first ever black president.
That I will.
Barack Hussein Obama is not the most common name in the United States. Born to a white Kansan woman and a Kenyan African father, raised by his grandparents in Hawaii. All of those things scream exotic.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
Obama became the center of a conspiracy theory. The claim that he was born outside the US and was not entitled to be president. In 2011, the so-called birther conspiracy received a massive boost.
Our current president came out of nowhere. The people that went to school with him, they don't even know, they never saw him. They don't know who he is. Crazy.
He saw this as an opportunity, he plucked it. He used that to sort of pole vault himself into a tete-a-tete with the President of the United States.
When we did polling in the spring of 2011, we saw that a great number of those people who felt that President Obama was not a real American went to Mr. Trump because he was very openly embracing this theory that legitimized it for those people.
I think that Trump has an ability because of his stature, because of his name identification and the fact that he's so well known, to take issues that are not in the mainstream and inject them into the mainstream.
In response, Obama called a White House press conference to put an end to the birther's conspiracy once and for all.
We do not have time for this kind of silliness. We got better stuff to do.
he released a copy of his full birth certificate, showing that he was born in the U.S. state of Hawaii in 1961.
I am really honored, frankly, to have played such a big role in hopefully getting rid of this issue.
Always optimistic.
Clearly, Donald Trump was driving Obama crazy. Trump was able to elevate the issue to the level that Obama felt compelled to respond. To me, that shows that Trump had an enormous impact.
My fellow Americans.
But Obama was about to get his revenge. 3 days after the release of his certificate, he ridiculed Trump in a speech to the White House press corps.
No one is happier, no one is prouder to put this birth certificate matter to rest than the Donald. And that's because he can finally get back to focusing on the issues that matter. Like, did we fake the moon landing? Well handled, sir.
We thought that that would put it to bed, and for the vast majority of the American people, it did put it to bed. But not for Donald Trump, because he was using it as a means to build support for his presidential run.
If Obama thought the release of his birth certificate would kill the conspiracy, he was about to get a shock. His certificate shows Barack Hussein Obama II was born here at Kapi'olani Maternity and Gynecological Hospital in Honolulu. But within days, it was labeled a fake. And leading the charge was the recently humiliated property tycoon and reality TV star, Donald Trump.
He is a citizen. He produced that long-form birth cert.
Well, a lot of people don't agree with you, and a lot of people feel it wasn't a proper certificate.
Orly Tates is a Californian dentist, originally from Moldova, and a leading light in the birther movement. She believes she found a mistake in how Obama's father's race was recorded and thinks it indicates forgery.
This is so bad, it's like it's done by a retarded five-year-old. In those years, in 1961, when they were describing races on birth certificate, they would put white, Asian, or Negro, or black. In Barack Obama's alleged birth certificate on this piece of garbage, they're saying African. Well, they didn't use the word African. This is not linguistics of 1961. That was created today using the wording of today.
As Orly Tates prepared to legally challenge the authenticity of the birth certificate, she was joined by Paul Irie, who has over 50 years' experience in typesetting.
It's the biggest fraud in maybe the history of the world.
He says there is evidence that the certificate was forged on a computer. Here, black letters are printed on paper that is solid green. But around the letters are white, halo-like outlines.
White on a back document that is printed on a green paper? How did the green go away? It can't. We see white, and the printer doesn't print white. White can't show up on that document. And that is proof by itself, beyond a question.
Numerous legal challenges over the birth certificate have all been thrown out. But the birthers are not giving up.
I've been accused of being wacko. I don't present evidence to people that's a lie. I concoct it. Look, I'm a Christian. I don't lie. I'm known for that.
Donald Trump claimed he was so concerned that he was also investigating Obama's birth certificate.
Was it a birth certificate? You tell me. You know, some people say that was not his birth certificate. So maybe it was, maybe it wasn't.
So just how credible is the evidence that the certificate is a fake? Ivan Zatkovich is a court-recognized technology witness who has forensically examined the halo effect. He separated the digital file released by the White House into 9 different layers. From this, he deduced it was a scan of the original birth certificate, produced using OCR, an optical character recognition program.
One of the things that OCR software does to enhance the edges is to create contrast enhancement. Contrast enhancement has multiple effects. It will make the black text blacker. It will make the background slightly lighter, sometimes causing what's called a halo effect. Purely based on the evidence of that PDF itself, I would be probably 80 to 95% confident that the layers were produced by simple contrast enhancement and OCR. The theories of the forgeries are easy to disprove.
President Obama is the least transparent president in the history of this country. If he gives his passport, applications, and records, I will give to a charity of his choice a check immediately for $5 million.
It doesn't matter whether you're black or white or Hispanic or Asian.
Obama didn't take Trump up on his offer and went on to get re-elected in 2012.
Gay or straight, you can make it here in America if you're willing to try.
A year later, in 2013, the birther conspiracy would take another extraordinary twist. Minutes after this Cessna Grand caravan plane took off from a Hawaiian island, its single engine failed.
Looking outside, you know, can I make it to land? No, there's no way. Okay, prepare for ditching.
All 8 passengers and the pilot struggled to stay afloat for almost 2 hours before rescue.
Everybody okay?
Later, it was announced that one passenger had died. Loretta Fuddy was the Hawaiian health official who had authenticated Barack Obama's birth certificate.
I had no idea who Loretta Fuddy was. None. And somebody told me, he says, oh, she's the one that signed Obama's birth certificate. And I go, oh, here we go. The village idiots are going to be coming out in force. Sure enough.
Shortly after Donald Trump heard the news, he took to Twitter and wrote, how amazing. The state health director who verified copies of Obama's birth certificate died in plane crash today. All others lived.
The director of health who had the birth certificate died today and everybody else lived. What does that mean?
Neil Abercrombie appointed Loretta Fuddy while he was the governor of Hawaii.
The implication of that tweet is that she's dead and that somehow is connected to the president of the United States in some ill-conceived and misbegotten attempt to prove where he was born. That is it goes beyond an individual sickness.
An allegation was made that Loretta Fuddy, as director of health, took a bribe to lie and say that Obama's birth certificate was authentic. Bertha Doug Voigt claims he found evidence in her financial records that her debts were being paid off at a rate exceeding her official income.
If she paid off $70,000 worth of debt, with lowered mortgage and credit card stuff, then where'd the extra money come from? She's short at least $50,000. That's the whole point. You're buying the forgery. You got to pay people off. In my opinion, they did.
The timing of her death made Voigt suspicious, because the previous week, he told a radio show what he thought he'd found out about her.
1 week she was dead after I did that interview.
The last person on earth who would be involved in such a sordid affair, like taking money to forge a birth certificate, would be Loretta Fuddy. Is a sad commentary on the desperateness that some people have in them, the sickness that they have in them over the fact that a black man is president of the United States.
Former Governor Abercrombie is a personal friend of Barack Obama. Voigt believes that Abercrombie masterminded the whole deception. And it was he who involved Loretta Fuddy in the plot.
By bumping her off, they don't have that link to Abercrombie and the president. The big guys who paid for this conspiracy, they start killing off everybody below them who gets close, who could lead to them. That's what usually happens. That's what plausible deniability is all about. If someone put a small bomb over the magneto and blew all the magneto, it would end the voltage to the cylinders and plane would lose power, just off the bat, just like that.
So is there any credibility to the claim that the plane was sabotaged? Loretta Fuddy's family hired a lawyer to investigate the circumstances of her death. He says he discovered that identical planes had previously experienced the same engine failure.
I believe this is at least the fourth one of this particular Cessna that failed for that very reason. So it wasn't something mysterious that someone did to this aircraft.
The engine manufacturer, Pratt & Whitney, Canada, and plane operator Makani Kai Air paid undisclosed sums to Fuddy's family. Fuddy's autopsy revealed the cause of death was heart failure as she struggled to stay afloat in the water. Her family's lawyer found no evidence of suspicious payments in her accounts. But these facts are not enough to persuade the most committed birthers.
I don't believe them as far as I can throw them. Got the picture? It's like Churchill not believing of a word that came out of Hitler's mouth. Same thing. Good analogy? Got it.
Donald Trump's championing of the birther conspiracy seems to have had a dramatic impact.
In 2009, 45% of Republicans nationally said that they thought that Barack Obama was not born in the United States. Now, after Donald Trump has given this issue so much attention over the years, and his surrogates have, that number's up over 60%.
Ironically, Trump himself had gone as far as he could with the birther movement and put the whole thing to bed earlier this year.
President Barack Obama was born in the United States, period.
One event, more than any other in recent American history, has become a fertile breeding ground for conspiracy theories.
Something has happened in the motorcade. Stand by, please.
The assassination of President John F. Kennedy. The official investigation ruled that Lee Harvey Oswald was the killer, acting on his own. Many Americans have just never bought the story.
Mainstream media has concealed a lot of facts about American history. Things are never exactly the way the government tells them. Even 71% of the people in America today don't believe Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone.
And it's this belief that Donald Trump would exploit on his next step towards the White House. In June 2015, he finally announced he was standing to be the Republican nominee for the presidency.
I am officially running for President of the United States. We will make America great again. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Trump's biggest challenger was Senator Ted Cruz from Texas, an evangelical Christian, an arch conservative. Cruz traded on his honesty and integrity.
Do we support a campaign that is based on yelling and screaming and cursing and insults? Or do we support a campaign that is a positive, optimistic, forward-looking, conservative campaign?
We have Lion Ted Cruz. I have to be honest. These people that I'm dealing with are the worst people.
He called Ted Cruz Lion Ted, said he puts his hand on the Bible, takes it off, and then he lies and lies and lies. And oh my gosh, that was Ted Cruz. I don't care about rough tactics. I don't like liars.
Along with these attacks, it wasn't long before Trump jumped on yet another conspiracy theory. This time, it was linked to Cruz's father.
Ted Cruz's father linked to JFK assassination. What's wrong about that? That's an accurate representation of what the story was.
What was he doing with Lee Harvey Oswald right shortly before the death, before the shooting? It's horrible.
Donald Trump, by invoking the Inquirer report, was able to elicit a response from Ted Cruz that effectively made him a spontaneously combustible political candidate.
Now, let's be clear. This is nuts. This is not a reasonable position. This is just kooky. And while I'm at it, I guess I should go ahead and admit, yes, my dad killed JFK. He is secretly Elvis, and Jimmy Hoffa is buried in his backyard. This man is a pathological liar.
Why did Trump raise this? To get under Ted Cruz's skin. Did it work? Like a charm.
Ted got emotional about it, and I think he got emotional about it because it was his father. Like, when you run for president, the idea that it would bring pain on your family is an emotional thing.
I don't know his father. I met him once. I think he's a lovely guy. All I did is point out the fact that on the cover of the National Enquirer, there was a picture of him and crazy Lee Harvey Oswald. But they never denied. Did anybody ever deny that it was the father? They're not saying, oh, that wasn't really my father. It's a little hard to do, because it looked like him.
Rafael Cruz was born in Cuba. During the Cuban Revolution, he fought with Fidel Castro's rebels against the ruling military dictatorship. He fled to America in 1957.
America is the land that welcomed my father as a penniless immigrant. He'd seen oppression, prison, and torture in Cuba. And for him, America was hope.
The National Enquirer alleges that after Fidel Castro took power and was viewed as a threat by America, the Cruz family tried to hide Rafael's past.
Ted Cruz had lied about his father's links to the pro-communist regime of Fidel Castro.
It was investigative journalist Wayne Madsen who first looked into Rafael Cruz's background in detail. He believes the photograph is evidence of a much deeper conspiracy. He identified the similarities between Rafael Cruz and the man beside JFK's killer.
He's never told anybody where he was on August the 16th, 1963, although there's some photographic evidence that would show that there's a guy that looked an awful lot like him standing there with Lee Harvey Oswald on August the 16th, 1963. But it's a yes or no. It's a simple question which he's never answered.
After a return visit to Cuba, Rafael Cruz claimed he became disillusioned with Fidel Castro's brand of communism.
We all thought he was the solution to the dictatorship that was in Cuba. We were all fooled.
Madsen believes the CIA then recruited Rafael Cruz to spy on other Cubans in the southern states, suspected of being communists. But Madsen goes even further. He also believes Lee Harvey Oswald was recruited and set up a bogus branch of the pro-Castro organization Fair Play for Cuba as a front for the CIA operation.
In the intelligence business, that's called a flypaper operation. This was a CIA ploy. Let's see who we can trust in the Cuban community that came to the United States and who we can't trust.
In this footage, Oswald is handing out Fair Play for Cuba leaflets with a man Madsen believes is his CIA partner, Rafael Cruz.
I think that was him standing there with Oswald.
Madsen also claims Rafael Cruz fled the country rather than face an investigation.
I believe Rafael Cruz in 1967, when the New Orleans district attorney was going full steam ahead with his investigation of the Kennedy assassination, that Rafael Cruz, in order not to be called as a witness by the New Orleans district attorney, used his connections in the oil industry to leave for Calgary.
Rafael Cruz denies he was in New Orleans at the time and has called the claims ludicrous. And Madsen has never had his story published by serious journalistic publications.
One thing about the tabloids is, well, maybe the person who reads the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times isn't seeing this, but God, all those ladies that are checking out through the supermarket lane at their local store will certainly see it.
But is the evidence that Rafael Cruz was with JFK's killer credible?
Garbage. Garbage. You know, I think that's the problem. It's easy to throw garbage into the middle of our national political conversation now in a way that it never was before.
Even the National Enquirer couldn't be certain it was Rafael Cruz, despite their dramatic headline.
In our article, we actually discounted the story to some extent. We said that there were some experts who said that they couldn't conclusively identify one way or the other if indeed the man in the photograph was Ted Cruz's father.
99% of their publication, it's all fabrication. I guess you could call it entertainment for the conspiracy-minded. There's just no evidence that Rafael was anywhere near Lee Harvey Oswald, so no. It's just bogus.
But the damage was done.
I've said that I would continue on as long as there was a viable path to victory. Tonight, I'm sorry to say, It appears that path has been foreclosed.
I humbly and gratefully accept your nomination for the presidency of the United States.
I accept your nomination for president of the United States.
With Hillary Clinton winning the Democratic nomination, Donald Trump faced the ideal opponent for his unique brand of conspiracy theory politics.
Between 55 and 65% of registered voters in this country do not believe the words honest and trustworthy apply to her. In any other election, that is a huge deal and a huge problem for a nominee. Why is it less of a big deal in this election? Because Donald Trump's numbers on honest and trustworthiness are even worse.
And her husband, Bill, has been mired in more scandals than perhaps any other American president. From the outset, the Clintons were embroiled in controversy. Their property company, Whitewater, went bust, and their business partners were later jailed for fraud. Then there were accusations of cronyism after they sacked staff in the White House travel office, replacing them with friends and supporters. And the man responsible for handling these sensitive matters was Vincent Foster.
The Clintons are more like a crime syndicate than they are a family. He was the keeper of all their secrets. He was their lawyer.
6 months into Bill Clinton's presidency, Foster was found dead with a gun in his hand here in Fort Marcy Park, just outside Washington.
And it is very important that his life not be judged simply by how it ended, because Vince Foster was a wonderful man.
Rumors spread about the man who may have known too much about Whitewater and the Clintons' complex web of financial and real estate dealings.
I believe he was murdered by persons unknown, for reasons unknown to me. And a cover-up ensued that was at bottom politically driven.
23 years after Foster's death, Donald Trump reinvigorated the conspiracy.
A lot of people are very skeptical as to what happened and how he died. I know nothing about it. But again, if you people reveal something to me, I'll answer it the appropriate way.
Donald Trump, it seems to me, understands that the people who believed in those theories, the Clinton haters, if you will, exist and were ready to be reactivated out there on the internet, and that by sending these signals to them, he would have a certain constituency. He's rallied that constituency.
Some of Trump's closest allies accuse Hillary Clinton of criminally covering up the circumstances of Foster's death.
My own research indicates that Hillary Clinton had two of her flunkies move the body to Fort Marcy Park so that Vince Foster's office would not become a crime scene. Why do I think his body's dumped? Well, they find his body 30 yards down a muddy trail, but there's no mud or dirt on his shoes, none whatsoever. There are carpet fibers all over his suit, however, that's because they rolled him in a carpet to get him out of there.
Later, it is claimed secret papers were removed from Foster's White House office.
Records pertaining to the nefarious activities of the Clintons. Who knows? It could have been anything. They have, you know, these people are a scandal a minute.
This suicide note has been the source of many claims that Foster's death is suspicious.
I agree with Donald Trump when he claimed that he believes this to be fishy. This note is fishy, and it does stink to the high heaven.
Confusion exists about exactly how it was found. A police team searched Foster's office 2 days after he was found dead. White House lawyer Bernard Nussbaum says he searched Foster's briefcase and told a police officer there was nothing in it.
He definitely indicated that the briefcase was empty and then again spread the opening wide and looked in it a second time.
3 days later, the note was found by a White House staff member in the same briefcase, torn into 27 pieces, despite Nussbaum's claim that it had been empty.
If the note had been in the bottom of that briefcase, he would have seen it.
Questions were now being asked about whether the note was genuine. Handwriting expert Ronald Rice examined a copy of it in 1995 for a political newsletter.
The more I looked at it, the more I studied it, the more I slept on it, the more this, the more that, I just could not come to the conclusion that the note was in fact authentic.
Rice managed to obtain earlier samples of Foster's handwriting in order to compare them to the suicide note.
You can plainly see how smooth and clear and clean and pristine that writing sample is compared to this about a month later. It's broken up. We have two words which read Clinton, Clintons, plural. You can plainly see on the known Vincent Foster, capital C is different from the question capital C. The I in the N is quite different from the I in the N created in the question suicide note. The T is obvious. This is the known T. This is supposed to be the stem in the question document of Clinton. So we have in excess of 14 points of dissimilarity. Not similarity, dissimilarity.
For Rice, this means only one thing, forgery.
On a scale of 1 to 10, probably a 2, amateuristic, sloppy. I've seen better by kids.
So, was there a conspiracy to make Foster's death look like a suicide? Official investigations found that Foster shot himself in the mouth, resulting in an exit wound in the back of his head. A clear indication of suicide. But citizen investigator Hugh Sprunt found a document which convinces him of foul play.
We found the medical examiner's report, which is a two-page report. It's a Virginia medical report. It's a report by Dr. Howe.
Sprunt believes that in the report, the location of the exit wound on Foster's body has been altered.
You look at the word that was, looked like it was kind of eliminated. It's four letters. Could it be neck?
An exit wound in the neck could suggest an alternative to suicide. And Sprunt discovered a second reference to the neck.
Whoever did the alteration, because clearly it was altered, didn't notice the word neck on page 2. So the document as it officially exists is completely inconsistent because of the alteration. I believe he came to grief elsewhere. I believe, in fact, he was murdered elsewhere.
Despite the passing of more than two decades, the issue resonated with U.S. voters after Donald Trump raised it.
In a poll we did shortly after that, we found that 50% of Trump voters had thought that Hillary Clinton had something to do with killing Vince Foster, and that's truly something that's unprecedented in American history. We've been divided over the years, but you usually don't have a situation where supporters of one candidate hate the other candidate so much that they think that that woman might be a murderer.
Dr. Donald Hout was the only medical examiner to inspect Foster's body in Fort Marcy Park. This is the first time he has returned to the scene since that day in 1993.
There's one of the cannons. See it? See it?
We showed him his medical report, which Hugh Sprunt had found, and asked why there was a reference to a neck wound. He says it is a record of what police initially told him before he examined the body.
That was what was reported to me, but not what I saw. That was what was reported to me, but that, in my opinion, was incorrect. I observed no neck wound.
Dr. Hout also rejects conspiracy theories that Foster did not die in the park, or that there was foul play.
Donald Trump said that the outcome was rather fishy or uncertain, but there was no uncertainty about it whatsoever at all. Without question, he killed himself. Yes, without question.
So, what about the suicide note?
I'm not a conspiracy theorist. Prove me wrong. Prove me wrong.
We asked another handwriting examiner to compare the same samples of Vincent Foster's earlier handwriting with the suicide note.
It's not a forgery because there's too many similarities. I don't think anybody can recreate this baseline without knowing how he held a pen and the angle of the pen and where his fingers were held. And then that alone is hard enough to recreate. But to do it in the same words, it's not possible. I've never seen it done like that. I'm completely confident, and I would take an oath in a court that the suicide note was performed by the same writer who wrote the known writings.
At least five official investigations have found that Foster's death was suicide.
I remember very clearly the day he committed suicide. We all knew him. It was an awful, tragic day. The president gathered us to talk to us about it. They were clearly devastated. I think he was just a deeply troubled man who felt he'd let the White House down, and with tragic consequences. It's as simple as that. And it's a tragedy, and conspiracy theorists often have zero basis in fact, and this is one of them.
But this wasn't the only controversy the Clintons faced in the 90s. And it's Bill Clinton's alleged sexual misdemeanors that have engulfed his wife's presidential bid.
What he's done to women, there's never been anybody in the history of politics in this nation that's been so abusive to women.
When Bill Clinton was governor of Arkansas and running for the White House in 1992, the first scandal involving relations with other women broke. A cabaret singer named Jennifer Flowers was outed in a tabloid magazine as Bill Clinton's lover. The Clintons decided to confront the scandal jointly in a TV interview. Bill Clinton's closest advisor at the time, Dick Morris, says he was consulted about tactics.
Bill called me right before the interview, and he asked me, what do you think I should say? And I said, well, if I were you, I would say that you have caused pain in your marriage, and you regret that, and you want to be a better person. But Franklin Roosevelt was not always faithful to Eleanor, and Eisenhower was not always faithful to Mamie, and Kennedy was not always faithful to Jacqueline, and Lyndon Johnson was not always faithful to Lady Bird. And I prayed that I could be half as good a president as they were. And he said over the phone, he said, oh man, that's good, but if I said that, I'd have to find a new place to live.
Now, I'm not sitting here as some little woman standing by my man like Tammy Wynette. I'm sitting here because I love him and I respect him and I honor what he's been through and what we've been through together. And you know, if that's not enough for people, then heck, don't vote for him.
The next day, Jennifer Flowers held her own press conference.
Yes, I was Bill Clinton's lover for 12 years.
First woman to come forward became a client of mine, Jennifer Flowers.
And for the past 2 years, I have lied to the press about our relationship to protect him.
And she told the media that she had had this relationship with Bill Clinton. She had an audio recording of him calling her, saying, be quiet about this.
Judge for yourself if this is the way a man talks to a woman who is just a friendly acquaintance.
If they ever hit you with it, just say no and go on. There's nothing I can do.
Raise your right hand and repeat after me. Protect.
Nevertheless, Bill Clinton was elected president later that year.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
But another sex scandal followed. In 1998, a White House intern called Monica Lewinsky claimed that the president had engaged in sexual activity with her in the Oval Office. True to form, Bill Clinton went into denial mode.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky.
It took us a year to prove that the conspiracy theories about Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky were true. Luckily, she kept the dress. But you have to prove the scandals of Democrats with DNA.
Indeed, I did have a relationship with Miss Lewinsky that was not appropriate.
Other women came forward to allege affairs with Bill Clinton. But allegations were also circulating that Hillary Clinton had enabled her husband's behavior by trying to silence women who came forward.
This is Hillary's modus operandi. It's not that she's an enabler. She's, frankly, a criminal that tries to obstruct justice and keep people from talking.
One of Bill Clinton's closest advisors at the time, Dick Morris, claims he was told about what was going on.
Bill's chief of staff and Hillary's close friend sat down with Bill and got a list of all of the women he was involved with. And she told me it was certainly more than a dozen. And she hired detectives to dig up dirt on each of these women. And then went to the women and said, if this comes out, we're going to say this and this and this about you. Your abortion, your previous divorce, your bankruptcies, your student loans, your cheating, your shoplifting, you know, what have you. And they dug up that dirt to intimidate the women into silence.
While the Clinton camp denies these allegations and dismisses them as conspiracy theories, Donald Trump has pushed them relentlessly.
And she was a total enabler. She would go after these women and destroy their lives. Hillary hurt many women, the women that he abused.
Trying to make it like Hillary was somehow in any way condoning of this behavior is just reprehensible and disgusting, and I don't think it's going to work. The problems that Hillary and Bill have had during their marriage is infidelities are well known, and to charge her as being an enabler is just a debase on false attack that I think will backfire on Donald Trump.
This narrative has never been fully exposed in the mainstream media, but it's fair game. If Hillary Clinton wants to call Donald Trump a misogynist, she's opening the door to an examination of her own conduct.
The scandals surrounding Hillary Clinton can sometimes seem endless. The most recent concerned her period as Secretary of State under President Obama. It emerged that she used a private email server for official business.
Hillary Clinton created an illegal private email server, deliberately, willfully, and with total premeditation. Could be the first way was right, actually.
Some in the intelligence community watched in amazement at what was playing out in public in relation to the handling of America's secrets.
The fact that someone who was the Secretary of State had, in this instance, the bad judgment to set it up this way and the even worse judgment to try to attempt to defend it.
I did not email any classified material to anyone on my email. There is no classified material.
Following a subpoena for work-related emails, Hillary Clinton's team deleted over 33,000, claiming they were personal. The FBI recovered some of them and found that thousands were work-related, and some were classified. From an additional 30,000 emails that she did hand over, the FBI found 110 of them were also classified.
And here now you have Secretary Clinton saying there was no classified. And after it was pointed out that, well, that is classified, then the claim became, well, they weren't classified at the time the emails were sent. And again, that's inconceivable for someone of my background. Information doesn't get classified by sitting on a server. It begins life as either classified or unclassified information.
It's either criminal or it's incompetent. It's one or the other. And neither's acceptable to be president.
I would lose respect for a whole bunch of intelligence organizations around the planet if they had not had full access to that server and were not, as we speak, thumbing through all the emails that were available.
At the end of the original year-long investigation, the FBI said it would not prosecute Clinton, despite some damning revelations.
There is evidence that they were extremely careless in their handling of very sensitive, highly classified information. We found no evidence that any of the additional work-related emails were intentionally deleted in an effort to conceal them in some way.
There has never been anything like this where emails and you get a subpoena, and after getting the subpoena, you delete 33,000 emails.
It's just awfully good that someone with the temperament of Donald Trump is not in charge of the law in our country.
Because you'd be in jail.
In a democratic republic, we have laws that govern the use of government computers and making sure that the public has a record of what you're doing in office. And she didn't want the public to have that record.
Donald Trump is trying to desperately find anything that he can put out there to cause doubt in Hillary's honesty and integrity, and so he's going to keep harping on this drip, drip, drip with no basis for really any investigations or criminal activity, but he's grasping at straws because he can't run on anything other than fear and conspiracy theories.
The FBI's decision is outrageous. This is elite deviance. This proves yet again that there are some people in the country so powerful, so connected, so wired, that the law just doesn't apply for them. The Clintons have skated on this basis for a long time.
When Hillary Clinton complains about conspiracy theories, it's usually because she doesn't like the idea that people are talking about her misconduct. And she tries to label it as a conspiracy theory to keep people away from talking about it. Mrs. Clinton has a record of corruption. That's not a conspiracy theory.
But just 11 days before the election, the FBI announced it was reopening the investigation. And some in the Clinton camp now allege a conspiracy against them.
She's complaining about how the timing is political and it's all out about her election. The timing is a result of her efforts to cover it up and the State Department's efforts to enable it. And these records should have been released years ago.
But despite his relentless attacks on Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump has not had everything his own way. An increasingly hostile media has dug up a huge amount of dirt on him.
I did try and fuck her. She was married.
That's huge news.
I moved on her like a bitch, but I couldn't get there, and she was married.
This was locker room talk. I'm not proud of it.
Since the recording was leaked, more than 10 women have publicly accused Donald Trump of sexual assault. But according to Trump, he himself has now become the victim of a conspiracy.
These attacks are orchestrated by the Clintons and their media allies. The only thing Hillary Clinton has going for herself is the press. Without the press, she is absolutely zero.
The media, they need to say something other than racist Hitler, in order to attack Donald Trump. But, oh, Hillary, isn't she great? She's a girl doing all this. It's amazing. She's doing it backwards and in heels.
And our system is rigged. Anyone who challenges their control is deemed a sexist, a racist, a xenophobe, and morally deformed.
Trump is even implying that if he loses, he will be the victim of the ultimate political conspiracy, electoral fraud.
I hear these horror shows, and we have to make sure that this election is not stolen from us and is not taken away from us.
What he's doing is creating a set of circumstances. Election's rigged, the media's against me, these polls are, you know, leading people astray. That allows him on November 9th, if he does lose, to say, well, of course, I lost.
I will totally accept the results of this great and historic presidential election if I win.
Trump supporters argue he speaks for many millions of Americans who feel failed by a corrupt political establishment.
Donald Trump is no conspiracy theorist. He's no wacko. He represents a fundamental force that's sweeping the United States.
I take all of these slings and arrows gladly for you.
He's not an ideologue. He's not a reactionary. Certainly isn't a racist, but he's certainly not out of charm school.
And I think you have a responsibility when you're the major party's nominee, when you're this much in the public eye, when you're pushing out these crazy conspiracy theories and no facts to back them up, that's dangerous.
Let's be very clear. The Clintons are not just facing defeat, they're facing prison. Prosecution and prison, and therefore it's all or nothing for them. I think they'll do anything necessary to win this election, including cheating.
He refused to say that he would respect the results of this election, and that is a threat to democracy.
This is a conspiracy against you, the American people, and we cannot let this happen or continue.
Panorama meets some of those who fear what Trump as president would mean for them, available on BBC iPlayer, and who will be supporting Donald. Radio 4 meets the Unswayables, Trump's loyal army, available online. Now, had you been watching BBC One, you'd have seen Lord Sugar fire another candidate. Perhaps tonight's was a surprise. You're fired next.